Hello students, welcome to today's class. Today we'll be dealing with a very important topic and a very interesting one also. We'll be seeing as to how different persons within the same field of psychology view abnormal behavior differently. Now, one thing which is very puzzling for other people is that in behavioral sciences such as psychology, there are often more than one explanations for each phenomena or more than one viewpoint for each phenomena. The more complex the phenomena, the more number of viewpoints or perspectives to explain it. Now, having a viewpoint or a perspective is very important because it actually gives you a kind of framework or a system within which you can organize all the data or the information you have about a particular psychological disorder. And based on this viewpoint, you can actually propose causation and do other researches, treatments, and studies. Although theoretical viewpoints do give a kind of framework or a system, what is actually disadvantages is that at times psychologists tend to hold their viewpoints so closely together or so rigidly that they often ignore other possible viewpoints which can have useful explanations for explaining abnormal behavior. In the field of abnormal psychology, the various perspectives and viewpoints have shifted across the centuries. For instance, there was first the biomedical viewpoint, followed by the psychodynamic viewpoint put forward by Freud. Then again came a different version of the biomedical viewpoint, which again gave a lot of importance to psychological and sociocultural factors. Then we had the behavioral viewpoint, the cognitive behavioral viewpoint, the cognitive viewpoint, then the humanistic existential viewpoint. And today, finally, after having seen such a number of perspectives, we have the eclectic viewpoint. And psychologists have finally realized that all these different viewpoints are right in themselves, but still they are like pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. You know, every piece is right, but unless you put all the pieces together, you cannot see the whole picture. And hence they take an eclectic approach combining all these viewpoints. In this class, first today we'll deal with the biological perspective or the biological viewpoint towards understanding mental disorders. Now, the biological perspective was the earliest perspective which developed in the field of abnormal behavior, and it saw abnormal behavior as resulting from brain dysfunction or pathology, and dysfunctions and problems in the central nervous system, the autonomic nervous system, the endocrine system, as also biochemical imbalances. According to the biomedical viewpoint, while the causal factors for mental disorders are essentially biological or emerge from brain pathology, it is only the symptoms which are cognitive, emotional, or behavioral. Now, as we know, the biomedical viewpoint received a great impetus with the discovery that general paresis, which was initially seen to be a mental disorder resulting in irreversible physical and mental degeneration, that this general paresis was in fact an advanced case of a physiological disorder, that is syphilis of the brain. Researchers belonging to the biomedical model or the biological viewpoint have put forward four major causes of abnormal behavior based on biology. Now, these causes include: number one, neurotransmitter and hormonal imbalances; number two, genetic vulnerabilities; number three, temperamental differences; and number four, the function of brain plasticity or brain flexibility, or the tendency of the brain to change in accordance to influences from the environment. Now, the fact that mental disorders could have a basis in biology or could be caused by a number of factors such as neurological damage, a gross destruction of nervous tissue, biochemical imbalances, and other sources of dysfunction in the central or autonomic nervous system led to the belief that in fact all kinds of abnormal behavior could be explained in such simplistic terms, in terms of some kind of pathology underlying it on a biological basis. However, slowly psychologists have realized that it is not really possible to explain all kinds of mental disorders in terms of its physiological causes, and that psychological as well as sociocultural factors do play a very important role in causing mental disorders. They interact with biological factors and may play an independent or interactive role. The biological viewpoint or the biological discoveries, of course, have been correct to a certain extent, and in certain extent have been erroneous. But still, the biological viewpoint has had a great profound impact on our understanding of abnormal behavior. For instance, it has put forward as to how a number of mental disorders may actually have biological basis or biological causations. Secondly, since the 1950s, the emergence of the biological viewpoint has also led to the development of a number of drug therapies or medical treatments, and these drug therapies have been especially effective in controlling severe mental disorders and the courses of these disorders. For instance, say schizophrenia, which is a severe mental disorder. The immediate results also which biological therapies and drug treatments have attracted a lot of popular attention to the biomedical model, because all of us want to get cured instantly. We do not want to wait even for a second. But again, it led to an irrational expectation that probably the biological viewpoint would put forward cure-all effects and put forward cures for every kind of mental disorders, which was not true. But still, when we see it as a whole, the biological viewpoint and its emphasis on the human anatomy has greatly enhanced our understanding of mental dysfunction. An influential researcher, Gorenstein, actually points out two major disadvantages of the biological approach, or two common errors in which people think about the biological viewpoint. Firstly, just because you establish biological differences in two people, say one having schizophrenia and one not suffering from schizophrenia, we cannot actually determine that schizophrenia is an illness. But in most cases, we do say so and we do think so, which is wrong. Whether schizophrenia is an illness or not will actually depend as to whether it shows clinically significant impairment for the person in various levels of activity, such as occupational, social, or familial activities. Unless such a dysfunctional impairment results, even behavior comprising schizophrenia or biological differences between people having schizophrenia or not having schizophrenia will not determine whether schizophrenia is an illness. A second major misconception is that most mental disorders, if not all, are caused by biological factors. Now, this is a wrong notion. Of course, all kinds of behavior, emotions, and cognitions have some kind of biological elements happening in the brain. They can be reduced to some kind of biological functioning. But this is only the how of the behavior. This is not the causation or the why of the behavior. And the why of the behavior or the causation may be either psychological or biological. For instance, if a person is seeing a stressor, he may become anxious, he may become fearful. There will be corresponding changes in the body in terms of hypothalamic or hormonal functions, but this is only the process of behavior. The stressor or the feelings of stress may be caused by psychological stressors such as fear or conflicts, or it may be caused by stressors within the human body such as physiological dysfunction. Now we come to the second viewpoint or perspective that we are studying today, that is the behavioral perspective. Now the behavioral perspective arose as a criticism or arose against Freud's psychodynamic theories, and the behaviorists put forward that all the unconscious processes or unconscious conflicts and motivations which Freud proposed were the causes of mental disorders actually could not be studied objectively, and hence they did not prove a proper subject matter for psychology. The behaviorists sought to focus only on observable behavior, because that is the only observable part of human life and human reactions. And hence they believed that it is learning or the modification of behavior, either through acquisition or modification or maintenance or extinction of particular behaviors, that adaptive or maladaptive behaviors were acquired. Hence, they focused all their energies on how learning processes occur in the environment and how an individual learns different kinds of behaviors. Now, we'll be seeing certain important behavioral approaches. As we know, the first and the most common behavioral approach is classical conditioning, discovered by Ivan Pavlov. Now, according to classical conditioning, a conditioned stimulus or a neutral stimulus begins to acquire an unconditioned response just because of its pairing with an unconditioned or natural stimulus. Now, let us explain this in some details so that it may be easier for you. For instance, pain is an unconditioned stimulus because it naturally involves feelings or responses of fear. On the other hand, say for example the time of a day or a particular setting such as the hospital may be a neutral stimulus. In itself, it will not evoke any reaction. But when pain and a hospital setting are closely paired together, that is, the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus are closely paired together, then the unconditioned or natural response to pain, that is fear, is also shown towards the hospital or the conditioned stimulus. Now, a number of maladaptive behaviors can be learned in a similar form of conditioning. For example, a child who is bitten by a cat may associate the fear of the pain with the cat and slowly towards other animals, and such kind of classical conditioning can result in the formation of phobias and phobic disorders. A second behavioral perspective is that of instrumental conditioning. It was propounded by B.F. Skinner and others. In instrumental conditioning, the individual is actually an active organism who actively operates on the environment rather than passively waiting to respond to some stimuli, as is the case in classical conditioning. Now, when he actively operates on the environment in instrumental conditioning, he receives some kind of reinforcement from the environment. If the reinforcement is in the form of something good, then of course the behavior will continue. But if the environment punishes him for some sort of behavior, then of course the behavior will be curtailed. He will no longer behave in the same way. This is how children and all of us learn socially acceptable and unacceptable behavior. But the fact remains that the patterns of rewards and punishments that our environment gives is not always rational. It is not always good for good and bad for bad. Sometimes even behaviors which are maladaptive can have instant rewards. For instance, a person who smokes a cigarette for a first time or takes drugs for a first time may have an initial pleasurable experience that seems like a reward and serves to continue the maladaptive behavior leading to disorders. Now we come to a third behavioral perspective, that is observational. It was put forward by Albert Bandura, who felt that most of our behaviors are learned through observation and modeling of various persons or social models, not just by instrumental conditioning or trial and error or classical conditioning. According to him, we observe various persons in the environment, and depending upon our needs, depending upon attention, our capacities, our memory, we tend to imitate these behaviors. Also, he introduced the concept of vicarious reinforcement, not the direct reinforcement we get in classical or instrumental conditioning. Vicarious reinforcement is the reinforcement we see the model as getting, the model who we are imitating. And depending upon the kind of reinforcement we see the model is getting, we may decide whether or not to perform behavior. But again, the models that we have in our environment are not always good, as we know. And hence, modeling of a maladaptive behavior can lead to maladaptive behavior patterns. For instance, children model a great deal of aggression and violence that is shown on television and apply it to their day-to-day lives because they see the villains and the other people engaging in violence on television as people who are powerful and who get some rewards for harming or bullying others. Now, in their classic book, Personality and Psychotherapy, Dollard and Miller, two pioneering behaviorists, launched a very severe attack on psychoanalysis in the way that they explained Freud's entire psychoanalytic theory in behavioral terms. For instance, they put forward that the id's seeking of pleasure, as in the Freudian theory, is nothing but a seeking of reinforcement. Similarly, repression is nothing but thought stoppage which has been reinforced, because once disturbing thoughts are stopped, the reinforcement is in terms of mental peace or mental harmony, and again it leads to a further process of thought stoppage. So repression is nothing but thought stoppage. So Dollard and Miller's efforts put forward the basic foothold of behaviorist psychology, and it took nearly 15 to 20 years for this field to actually emerge out from the shadows of psychodynamic theories. Now, on the basis of a few concepts, behaviorists explain almost all aspects of behavior, adaptive and maladaptive. According to them, maladaptive behavior is a result of faulty learning. It is a result of either learning maladaptive behaviors or a failure to learn adaptive behaviors such as important social skills. and hence behavioral therapy focuses on specific treatments which are meant to change specific behaviors. For instance, mental patients may be taught basic learning skills or basic hygiene skills by reinforcing them at regular intervals. This will be an instrumental conditioning principle. So also, fears that are classically conditioned may be avoided by actually may be treated by exposing the person to the fearful situation, a classical conditioning principle. For example, if a child is afraid of cats because he has been bitten at some time, the child will be exposed to cats for a sufficient period of time so that he knows that not every cat bites him. And this will lead to an elimination of the conditioned fear. Now, the behavioral perspective has been criticized a lot because other critics feel that the behaviorists have explained all sorts of complex human behavior belonging to the complex human being as though the human being is a puppet controlled by two strings, stimuli and reinforcement. And hence they feel that the behaviorists have not been able to put forward the complexity and the dynamic nature of human behavior. Yet if we see, the behavioral perspective has contributed a lot to our understanding of psychopathology. In fact, it has been the basis for the development of the empirical and experimental traditions, and also behavioral therapies focusing on changing behaviors and thereby treating psychotherapy have been effective for a large number of disorders. And hence, psychology will always be thankful to the behaviorists for the pioneering changes they brought about in the field. A third perspective towards abnormal behavior, that is the cognitive perspective, emerged in the 1950s, and it was mainly a reaction against the behaviorist perspective. Cognitive theorists felt that the behaviorist view of mental disorders and mental illness is extremely mechanistic and doesn't take into account the fact that the human being is in fact a thinking organism. He thinks and behaves and acts in different situations rather than being passively controlled by certain stimuli and reinforcements. For instance, the cognitive theorists give a lot of importance to basic cognitive processes such as attention and memory, and higher cognitive processes such as thinking, reasoning, and problem solving. Within the cognitive perspective, we'll first deal with Albert Bandura and his theory of self-efficacy. Albert Bandura was a theorist who put forward the cognitive behavioral theory of learning and behavior. He felt that we are not only motivated and influenced by external stimuli and reinforcement, but also stimulated by our own thoughts, feelings, and analysis of different situations. And we are not only motivated by external reinforcers, but may also have intrinsic or internal reinforcers and rewards that pull us and push us towards certain behaviors. For instance, if you take an example, we take our car regularly to the garage for a regular checkup, not because the garage gives us any external reinforcement to do so, but because we can think and we can see ourselves stranded on a road, probably at midnight or probably at any time of the day. And to avoid that and to avoid such a punishment, we go ahead and take our car to the garage. So this is an intrinsic reinforcement. Our thoughts are giving us the reinforcement that yes, if you take your car to the garage, you won't have to face such a situation. Albert Bandura also put forward his theory of self-efficacy, or the individual's belief that he can actually accomplish certain goals and reach certain aims in life. He felt that individuals are capable of self-direction and actually regulating their life. They don't need external stimuli or reinforcement to direct them. And the loss of self-efficacy, or the loss of belief in oneself, is seen as one of the major causes of mental disorders, and the cognitive perspective seeks to increase individuals' feelings of self-efficacy so as to increase his feelings of well-being. Now, another cognitive theorist who was very influential was Aaron Beck, who actually put forward as to how distortions in our thinking and distortions in our processing of information can actually lead to maladaptive behavior. He put forward his concept of the schema. Now, what is a schema? A schema is an underlying mental framework of knowledge. And we have a number of schemas relating to different things. For instance, we may have a schema of what different social situations are. We have a schema of what a marriage is, or what a marriage function is. We have a schema of what a cricket match is. Similarly, we may have schemas about different people and their professions. We have a schema of what lawyers are or how they will behave, or how doctors are or how they will behave. Similarly, we have self schemas or schemas about ourselves in terms of how we are, who we are, what are our capabilities, and what are our feelings of self-esteem and self-worth, what are our weaknesses, how others think about ourselves, and so on. Now, schemas are very useful because they help us in processing the information from different aspects of the world, because at any point of time we are bombarded with such a lot of information, and schemas tell us how to organize this information, which information to attend to, and in short, how to make sense of the external world. But the problem lies in the fact that not all our schemas are adaptive or normal. Sometimes our schemas may be maladaptive and wrong. The main factor is that we tend to hold even inaccurate schemas with a lot of conviction, and we are very rigid, and we do not tend to change our schemas even when we know that there is information which tells us that what we are thinking is wrong. And our schemas may also influence our behavior unconsciously. We may not even know that our thought processes are actually influencing our behavior. Now, there are two ways in which we fit new information into our cognitive framework. Either it may be through a process of assimilation. That is, we change the information in such a way that it fits our cognitive framework. If the external information tells us something that what you're already thinking is wrong, still you will modify the information in such a way that it fits into the existing framework. The other process of integrating external information is accommodation, by which you change your earlier thinking so as to include new information from the environment. And what cognitive therapists try to do is to actually engage the person who has some kind of mental disorder into the process of accommodation, so that actually he can remove and change his maladaptive thought patterns and adopt new and better thought patterns from the environment and new and correct information from the environment. That many people who have mental disorders also show thought biases. They tend to think only about certain pieces of information. For instance, depressed people are more likely to focus on the negative aspects of the situation rather than the positive aspects. Such kind of biases in thinking and information processing can also be a potent source of mental disorder. Now, the final factor we'll be studying in the cognitive perspective is attributional style. What is attribution? Attribution is the basic process by which we assign causes to events, that this event has been caused by this, or this is responsible for this event. And we tend to attribute causes for a wide variety of events. Unless we know why an event is caused, we do not understand it. So we attribute causes. Now, sometimes our patterns of attribution may be dysfunctional or maladaptive and can lead to the formation of mental illnesses. For instance, we see that depressed people tend to attribute negative elements to themselves and positive elements to their external environment. I'll tell you a short example. Say, for instance, a student who is depressed fails in the examination. He will say that I failed in the examination because I am not intelligent, I don't have the capabilities. On the other hand, an optimistic or normal student may actually attribute the failure to external causes. He will say, I failed because the question paper was difficult, or the invigilator was not good, or the teachers had not taught properly. Now, this can happen in normal situations also, but the fact is that depressed individuals tend to follow this maladaptive pattern of attribution continuously, and hence they feel low about themselves and feel depressed. Now, the cognitive viewpoint has been extremely influential because it has emphasized to us the importance of our thinking patterns, of our information processing patterns. It has shown us that it is not only our biological chemistry or not only environmental events that affect our behavior and cause maladaptive behavior or psychopathology. They have shown us that psychopathology can be a result of our own thoughts and our own interpretations of external events. And hence, well-being involves a removal of these distortive thought patterns and replacing them with constructive and positive thoughts. Now, the cognitive perspective has often been criticized for its emphasis on unconscious or unobservable processes such as thoughts and information processing. But still, cognitive therapies have shown a great deal of efficacy in dealing with a number of disorders, say anxiety, schizophrenia, depression, and other personality disorders. Now we come to the last perspective that we will be seeing in this lesson, and it is the humanistic perspective. Now, the humanistic perspective involves a lot of positivity. It sees human nature as good rather than as mechanistic or passive as the behaviorist and psychodynamic views have put forward. It sees the human being as capable of directing himself and moving towards growth and self-actualization, of building his life on a number of values such as positivity, love, creativity, personal growth, and fulfillment. So this is actually a very positive view of human nature, a being or an organism who is active and who is moving towards achieving his goals and achieving a sense of fulfillment and esteem. Now, one major theorist in the humanistic perspective is Abraham Maslow, and he's mainly noted for his concept that human beings are basically motivated towards self-actualization. Self-actualization, in other words, means attaining your potentialities to the highest level. For instance, Maslow says, a musician must make music, a painter must paint if he has to reach the highest level of satisfaction in life. What one can do, one must do. But of course, the process of self-actualization is not easy. You have to fulfill your basic needs, your safety needs, belongingness, and esteem needs, and then you reach self-actualization. But the basic fact is that most people are focused and directed towards that level of ultimate growth or actualization. The second and the last theorist we are going to study in the humanistic perspective is Carl Rogers. Now, Carl Rogers emphasized to a great extent the concept of the self. According to him, each person has a concept of I, me, or myself, or his own self. And there is a basic struggle going on in an individual. There is the self which he really is now, or the real self, and the self which he wants to become, the ideal self. And more the gap between the real self and the ideal self, the more the possibility for mental illness, the more the possibility for anxiety and depression, because always the individual is trying to become the ideal self. So the humanistic theorists and the humanistic perspective focuses on encouraging the individual to actually experience the environment fully, and to remove all obstacles towards personal growth and fulfillment so that the individual can adopt a rational idea of the self and become that rational self and develop a high degree of self-esteem and well-being. So in this lesson, we have seen four basic perspectives which have greatly influenced our understanding of mental disorders. First, we saw the biological perspective and the biomedical model. Then we saw the behaviorist perspective. Then we came to the cognitive perspective. And then we came to the humanistic perspective. And what we must remember is that all these perspectives are correct where they stand. And probably an amalgamation or a unification of all these perspectives together will give us a broad and comprehensive understanding of what mental disorders and psychopathology is.